Hello Steelers, and welcome to another Bench Report Hobby Update. A lot quieter this week than it was last week, you'll remember, with my visit to Larder Island and then also the Steel Warriors game, games day as well. This week has been a lot quieter, a lot calmer. I did actually manage to get some painting done, though. I was away for work for a little bit, so I've not gone done as much as I wanted to, but I've done bits and pieces, and that's the most important thing. The first thing was Yagpanther that Dex gave to me last week. I just thought I'd knock that together. I think I've already got one elsewhere in my collection somewhere, but this one's a nice one. It's a Battlefront one, really nice plastic kit, dead easy to put together, no problems with it whatsoever, and so thanks to you, Dex, for that. Thank you very much. Then I also painted the four Rolls-Royce armoured cars. These are going to be used in Through the Mud and the Blood, possibly very early Second World War stuff as well. If I do some 1940s things, they may make appearances. But these, again, mostly for First World War. These are from Richard Hogg, so once again, thank you, Richard, for sending those through. Wanted to get them painted up. I then also did some work on the Soviets that Dex had also given me as well. So these are for O Group. The early Soviets are made up of square battalions, which means each of their companies has four sections in them instead of three. So I actually just needed nine more sections for these just to go on the to add to the existing Soviets. So that's kind of what I did here. It was a very simple job, just labeled those up as well underneath so I know who they are, and basically I can either add them or take them away depending on when I'm playing. And I'm intending on doing some Eastern Fronts for O Group at some point as well. I was even thinking of maybe doing some later today, but we'll see how I feel. And then finally this week, painting wise at least, or finished painting wise, I did the what's called the Café Gondrieu. It's the cafe that is at the end of Pegasus Bridge, where there was obviously fighting around there. This is based on it. It's a 3D printer model, 50mm obviously, and I got this from Paul over at Sabotaged. I got a couple of these because I wanted some slightly different ones to the ones to the other 3D printer buildings I've got. I didn't actually realise it was this building, but it is, and I've got another one which I'm going to work on at some point. I just wanted to put some bushes and stuff in the back garden, so that's kind of what I was doing with that. It's a bit of an experiment to see if that would work, and it did, and I'm happy with how it turned out. A couple more of those. Now, Andy, friend of General Haig, has actually asked if I would do a video at some point of the the 3D printed buildings that I've actually done at this point, and it is a lot because I got them out the other day to look at them. And yes, I'm going to. I've not finished everything I've got. I've still got one or two bits and pieces here, but I think I might do a roundup video just of showing you what I paint, because I've been at them for a long time and it's difficult to see when I only show you one in each video, one or two, you know. I may as well put them all together and we can marvel at how many there is. I don't think I'll ever need another 3D printer building for a long, long time though. Currently this week as well, I've just been working on some of these barricades, 3D printed ones again, and also some 3D printed scatter terrain. This I'm going to be putting this into some of the buildings that I've already got. So this is just stuff I got from Paul at Sabotage. It's just a scattering of stuff, farmyard scatter and things, and I'm just going to paint those up probably throughout this week and just get them done, and then I'm going to glue those down onto some of the bases that I've already got, possibly use up just for scatter terrain as well here and there. And also then I started on Saturday work on this. It hasn't dried yet, but it looks like a big collapsed cake but it's going to be a double mine crater, and I'm going to be doing this using this for Through the Mud and the Blood, because the underground mines in the First World War were massive and they caused lots of craters. I've actually been looking into my family's history just relatively recently. I'll come back to that. But it was Tommy James, who I've been looking into in particular, was part of the Royal Irish Regiment, and in 1918 they attacked a crater area. I've got their battalion diaries. This was in August of 1918. I was going through their battalion diaries, and they attacked a crater. So whether I do a scenario based on that, but I thought, you know, craters come up quite a lot in First World War accounts, and these are huge, huge craters, and that's a double one that was blown under. German lines. So that's the idea for that. So yes, I was looking into his service record, or at least trying to find where the battalion was moving in 1918 when he joined. So I got the diaries for that, and then remembered, yes, craters are a big part of First World War wargaming, and to be honest, you very, very rarely see them on the tabletop. So I thought, let's go for it. I mean, obviously, I'm making a few shortcuts here and there because I can. It's got to be flat, but I want it, you know, at least up and over the top so you can get in and into it. It's one that's filled in because you know once the stuff comes up, it's got to go back down somewhere. So it has been filled back in with the material. So I'm going to wait for that to dry and then just get that sanded up and painted as well. So that's something I've been working on. Then. In the post, and also bought, this is something slightly interesting, at the club, I'll come back to this anyway, Dex gave me this stuff. This is Panzer Schokolade. This is, apparently it was given to German soldiers and it had amphetamines in it in the Second World War. This stuff doesn't, it's got 70% cocoa in it. I can't really see what it says, but it says something about lots of coffee in it. I think Black Ops Coffee it's called. I've got no idea where it came from, but thank you, Dex. I've not tried it yet, but I'm going to. I'm sure it'll be pretty heavy if when I do try it. But yeah, so thanks for that, Dex. But also, I was at Chilcon yesterday. I was over there with Dean, saw quite a few people, so hello to everybody I saw, all the guys from the club as usual, Carl as well, Carl Bergs, bumped into him, hello Carl, and so nice to see a bunch of people, and we were only there for a couple of hours. I'll come back to Chilcon in a second, but we were only there for a couple of hours, so it was nice to see people. But whilst I was there, I actually picked up 4 books. This is the only thing I bought, apart from some flesh-coloured paints. And I got the Battleground books. I've talked about these before, because I've talked about these with the Corps Select one. And these were only £5 each. So it was a good bargain. These were from Dave Lanchester, Lancaster Books. And I've got the Poisiers one here by Graham Keach. I got the Germans Tietval by Jack Sheldon. I also got the K.W. Mitchinson has written these two, and this is the Villers Pugh and also Riekeval, and these are the Hindenburg Line ones, so these are 1918. So I have quite a mix of things. And these are really, really good, and the fact that they were only £5, I thought, well, I'll grab those, because these are great for scenarios, for things like Through the Mud and the Blood, or any First World War wargaming, because they are really detailed. They go right down to platoon level. They've got some good maps in them. They've got some very good descriptions of the actions as well. You know, the work is done for you, basically. Just all you have to do is really pluck some of the information out of these. So that's the reason I got these, just to have a look at them, literally to pull out as much information about the for scenarios and things that I could. And I'll probably get some more. I've got loads of them anyway, but they're good. And I got rid of 260 Ospreys last week, so I'm trying not to fill my shelves up too much with books. But I think four is a relatively good replacement for the 260. Okay, so this week, gaming wise. But I was down at the club on Thursday. Dex and I continued with our third scenario of the Storming the Citadel campaign, pint-sized campaign. I was getting mixed up with Plastic Soldier Company, a PSC. And this was Panzermarsch. Now, I, as the attacker, I was getting, I got a fresh platoon in there anyway. But I got at least 10 points on my support. It was 10 points plus D6. I ended up with 14 points, so that gave me a forward observer for a mortar battery and, of course, a Tiger, because you've got to have a Tiger if you've got 10 points. It's a mobile cannon. That's literally all it is on the table. Dex did go anti-armour, and he did have a 76.2mm AT gun, which actually came up nowhere near. A fantastic game, but unfortunately for Dex, I think, like, I literally steamrolled him. is a short way of describing it. What I was trying to do, I was trying to use a few different ideas. I was pushing forward, leapfrogging with two of my platoons, getting two of my sections, getting them forward into firing positions, then moving the other one up, and then also pulling forward my jumping off points as well to release the third section to get them forward. I actually managed to get into a position over by one of Dex's other jumping off points, which in reflection, I think he'd put far too forward. It was in a really, really vulnerable position. I got within 6 inches of it, so I didn't shut it down, but then he'd charged me. So he immediately went into close combat, but he was up against a Panzer Grenadier section, and I had twin MG34s. It was fully, I think I had one shock. I was behind light cover. It was literally the worst position he could have attacked me in. He did it, and the results played out, and he was absolutely annihilated. Almost destroyed his force morale at that point. I'd already destroyed another section previous to that, because he'd only a few men, with the Tiger and with the other units on Overwatch. And then also, I was able then to move on to two of his jumping off points. Not only that, I then had a chain of command dice, so I was able to end the turn, which obviously closed up. I captured two of his jumping off points, which then of course meant that his morale collapsed. I think he was on 4 at that point, or 2. The minimum he could have got was 2 off his force morale, so it was game over. It was all over bar the shouting in about an hour, I think. He's very heavily battered at the moment, from a campaign point of view. He's got to hang on for at least, I think, 2 more games before he gets a fresh platoon in. He might get some replacements, but yes, I think it's going to be tough for him. However, my casualties are also going to start to show as well, I think, as well. But it's going to be interesting what the next game is, because I'm not using a fresh platoon. I'm going to have to go back to one of my original ones who have taken casualties. But yeah, it's going to be interesting. And then also I mentioned that Saturday I went over with Dean over to Chilcon, which is pretty much the local show for us now. To be honest, I was actually going to make a show report, but I came away a little bit deflated, slightly, to be honest with you. Now, the positives, before I do any criticism, the positives really are that it was incredibly well attended. There was loads of people there, which is great to see. Absolutely heaving with people when we got there about 10 o'clock. Really big queue to get in. You got a free figure, you got some Romans. I gave them to Dean, so that's why I don't have them to show you. They gave away quite a lot of bits and pieces, so that was great. And as I say, I'd fully intended to make a show report. I have done in the past at Chilcon. However, I looked through the brochure. There was only 11 games on, which I know it's a relatively small show, but it felt to me a little bit like the Traders. It was more of a trade show than anything else. The games that were there was one or two that were very good. There's some that I've seen before several times now, and also the variety of them. It was this is entirely the variety was mostly fantasy, or fantasy orientated. I'm not particularly interested in fantasy. There's no problem. I mean, if you want a fantasy show, then it's probably for you. But it just felt as though a lot of the games were being put on by people who were trying to sell you the game, which again is not a bad thing. But I'd just like to see some demo games. I'd like to see a few more participation games. Some of them, as I say, left me a little bit flat. Then I don't think they were great. I'm being a little bit critical. Perhaps if they had an extra space. Now, all right, you could say, well, yeah, everybody can be a critic, and it's true, everyone can be a critic. It's easy to criticise. So what I said to Dean afterwards is, I said, right, well, we've criticised this. We thought there aren't enough games on, so we'll put our money where our mouth is. And next year, we will apply to put a game on, probably a participation game. Not sure what it'll be yet, but if it'll come off, but that's what we said we'd do, and I'm more than happy to do that, because I think things should have support, and I really think that we should, the more people that put games on at these things, the better. Overall, as I say, I've mentioned it already, I saw a lot of people that I know, so that was nice. I just came away with the books and some paint. I very rarely buy a lot of stuff at shows these days anyway. But yeah, mixed feelings. You know, kudos to the guys that are doing it, and this is in no way a criticism of them and their efforts that they put in, because they went all the way through. I just think maybe just mix up a little bit, just get a few more games in. It seems the first time I went, it was absolutely ramp-packed, especially the main room was absolutely packed with games, and the second room was also pretty full of games. This time round, it just didn't feel like it at all. You know, I think we spent less than 2 hours there, maybe an hour and three quarters, and we were done. And that was having going round and stuff as well. So, you know, you pay your money, you take your chance, don't you, at the end of the day. I'm happy to support them, and I will go next year. And as I say, next year I will want to put on, I will endeavour to put on a game, and it will be a participation game. So, look out for that. Not much else to say, really. I think that's pretty much as I can say. As I said, very excitingly, on Friday I went with my mum to the local archives, met a guy who'd been researching he's my hero, he's one of my family's great uncle, Tommy James. He was an anti-fascist almost before the term was invented. He went and fought. He fought in the First World War, as I say, in the Royal Irish Regiment. At the moment, I'm just trying to work. I need to get his pension records, but they're down at Kew. So if anybody's out there and they're going to Kew, let me know and I can give you his service record. I've got all the other information about him. I just need to get his pension records so I can see when he joined up, so then I can start mapping out exactly where the battalion were and where he went, because already I've noticed that somebody has done some work on him in the past, but he's got some things wrong already. But I'm not trying to prove somebody wrong. I'm just trying to get a fix on what was happening. He then went and ended up fighting in the Spanish Civil War as he was a commissar with the in the International Brigade. He was a member of the Communist Party here in the UK. He fought in Rotherham, my hometown. He fought against Oswald Mosley and his black shirts when those fascist bastards came to town. They chased him out of town, basically, fought him off. So brilliant. You know, real hero of mine, this guy. He's now commemorated as well with a plaque in the town centre. There's also another monument to him as well in the town as well. And, you know, real stand-up fellow as far as I'm concerned. So it was really good to meet this guy who'd been doing a lot of research into Tommy. He pulled out a lot of the stuff from the archives. He was able to actually tell us some stuff about the family that we didn't know as well, which was very interesting, which I'm currently investigating at the moment as well. So, all interesting stuff as far as I'm concerned. And I'll wrap it up there, because that's family business, and you know, it's interesting stuff from a war point of view, or a military history point of view, but probably not a great deal of interest to you, my viewers. So anyway, if you've made it this long, thank you very much for watching. As always, hit the subscribe button. We are well over 10k at this point. Share this video around if you've enjoyed it, and I will see you in the next hobby update, bench report.